And here we go. Let's fuck up there something fierce. He will finally be a well-deserving Buscus champ. Was he ever Buscus champ? I don't quite remember. I don't think he ever competed for it in LPFWA 2. Could be, but I don't remember every match anymore. I could check, but you know, I'm lazy. In any case, I'm accompanying Lotus to the ring to make sure he beats up Dash properly. And yeah, I miss Sore as well. It's sad he didn't come back yet. Maybe he will, I don't know. After all, we are currently in contract negotiations with none other than Frederick Hope. But if Sore comes back, he will be the only one that I will give permission to have his entire outfit set to glowing, and it'll be amazing. It'll be like even like more garish and more horrible than before. By horrible, I mean great, the best. And hey, here's good old Ash. Gained some weight, but also a bit more poorly shaven, but he's back. He's very back, and he's ready to be punished for the thing that we mentioned the previous cutscene where he stole all my booze. Gotta take a drink though. Well, the funny part is that I could have given him a spice on his shoulder, but for some reason, that same, like, weird football-like armor thing with spikes is only for entrances, while this version, without the spikes, can be used in matches. Oh, Dash didn't just drink. Dash also, well, ate. There was a bit of an ad before the match. It was displayed on top of the screen, as ads usually are, and it mentioned some YouTube video that I hope doesn't exist really. I didn't check, but it's about Dash apparently eating some mayo pancakes. Here we go. Lotus starting strong with a dropkick straight to the face. Boy, am I glad that Ash is getting his ass kicked. Yeah, do it, Lotus. Yeah, DDT, nice. Aw, yeah, I'm into this already. You can tell, because Dash is the one who takes the punishment here. Ha ha ha, Rana, nice. Yeah. Yeah. Come on, do some more. Well, that's not so good. It looks like... Oh, well, never mind. Dash got very confused out of the ring there, just did nothing, and now they're going to the ramp, because hey, why not? Why not? Of course, there's counter. The ref already started counting. We're at 3 now, apparently. That's how it sometimes goes. At least Dash is the one who keeps taking all the hits. I don't think he got a single hit in yet. Just an Irish whip. And of course, because Lotus is honorable, he resets the count. Well, a loss by count is just, you know, a loss by count out here. In terms of Buscus champ transferal, it means that, hey, if you lose, you lose, even if it's by countout or DQ, and the title transfers. Oh, looky there! Dash gets some hits in now, isn't that amazing? Actually, it's quite bad, but hey, it's his, well, debut, kind of. His return. We're at 9 now? God damn it. Classic dash. What a heel way to win, isn't it? Nice angle, though. Oh well, I guess that means Dash isn't the Buscus champ. Well, he only got like 2 or 3 hits in anyway, so that's good at least. Oh, timeouts have happened before, mostly in Season 1. Because that was WWE 2K13, and there were a lot of countouts there, because, hey. Oh yeah! It's TNT. It's Dynamite. This guy. Dynamite. Yeah. Color TV screen. I shouldn't do that. I shouldn't do that. But I like that song. It's a very good song. And they really gotta adjust the entrance a bit for the core to start sooner, but I like that part of the ending there, that's my favorite bit of the entrance. And now, totally not a ghost, it's Woolsey. He's got a little bit of a pimp cane going there. Very nice. And now that he's not entering as a champion, he actually has this whole black and white screen effect. Which just rounds out the package, you know? I can already tell this is gonna be like last season where I got drunk constantly because I'm drinking. Not in kayfabe, because in kayfabe I'm sober, but yeah. Yeah. The fact that Dash won is just so devastating to me. I could've just made a no DQ match and just... I was in the match! I could've just done something. Now I blame myself, you see. That's how it works. Alright. This is Anil's debut. Well, he used to be different in Season 2. As opposed to Dash, who gained weight, he lost a lot of weight, and also hair and cat ears. He's also got a bit more unhinged. Before that, he was just your typical kind of really goony, nerdy guy with cat ears, and now he's that. He's that. Exactly what you see here. No more trench coat. No more cat ears. No more WWE 2K14 shirt. And a pinfall already! Ah, just a one count. Ah, yes. But yeah, that was... Highlights of Anil's career actually include... trying to expose the Standgate scandal, which never happened. That was a wet fart. Hey, that's a move, for sure. That's a move. And oh my god! He can do flips, holy crap! I gave him this moveset and I didn't even know he could do that. It's really... it's a thing. Let's just put it that way, it's a thing. You know, I'm somehow always disappointed when these kicks to the gut on the ground don't go straight to the balls. I don't know why, it's just... It's a thing that I expect. And a weird dance electrop, nice, really nice. And a standing moonsault? When he sure has a good moveset. Oh good, you're standing, wow. He's just styling on Woolsey here. Good thing he's already dead. I mean, probably. He denies that. But I'm pretty sure he's a ghost. Ghost elbow to the face. Another ghost elbow to the face. That must be revenge for the two moonsaults. But you know, the moonsaults are stylish. As opposed to like just an elbow drop. Standing elbow drop isn't quite the same thing as a standing moonsault. I think that was a Rainmaker. Angle was a bit bad, but... Well, a Rainmaker is nothing but a wristlock lariat. All I gotta say, Anil started strong, but now Woolsey's kinda making his comeback, nice back and forth here. Just gotta keep his momentum. Never mind, he's dead. Never mind. Everything's fine again. Or bad, depending on who you're rooting for. Actually, let me root for Anil, he deserves it. After I constantly rooted against him in the previous season. Ooh, is that his... That must be signature. I think that's a signature. An armbar DDT or something. Armbar takedown of some variety. From the top rope, of course. And that's what you call a head to the mat. Times three. I have no idea what that move was. It looked like Anil was supposed to do something, but hey, you know. Sometimes moves are a bit weird. I like when they do that. I think it was his finisher, goes for the pinfall and then goes for the dirty pin. But you know, in gameplay terms, you have a higher chance of pinning somebody after a finisher. And everything after that, if you kick him or something, it'll be lost. It'll be lost. It sucks. Hey, Woolsey kind of has a dirty fighting style, just rubbing the hat against the canvas. Kind of a dick move. And again, he's dead, so... He can just do whatever. What are you gonna do to him? You can't sue a dead man, after all. Was that a falcon? No, it wasn't a falcon. I don't know. That was a move. That wasn't his finisher, though. His finisher is a different one. His finisher is an Explorer suplex, but he won with that move, which is nice, I guess. Dynamite! Watch me explode! I'm sorry. I'm so sorry, guys. I didn't mean to. Do that. Mighty Unclean. That's a good song. Well, don't pity the ghost, Hellmaker. You say two losses in a row, but he died before, so that's an improvement. Back door and run for your life. You can tell I'm kind of into hard rock and metal, can't you? Oh well, I guess it's back to the tag team scene for Woolsey. But hey, the tree actually does have a match today that's not on the card. Well, it is on the card, but it's not on the canon card. First of all, though, here's the match for the Bunny Championship. The Masked Man versus the Majestic Goat Man, who kind of won it of Katire Arecho last time. So let's see what it has in store for us. But as I was saying, there is a match with the tree. He's gonna take on Roman Reigns at the end of the show in a bonus match. This is one of those weird heel versus heel matchups. We have a ton of those because we have so many heels. Hell, I'm a heel. Even though I book myself as a babyface, obviously. Because I just want to be loved by everybody. Yes. Well, that bottle is already pretty empty, considering that we're only like 20-ish minutes in. But it's fine, everything's fine. I'm sure it's gonna turn out very well in the end, and won't be embarrassing at all for me. And here comes Goldman to some Lacuna Coil. And he's gonna do the MGM out of nowhere and kill everybody. I love the Bunny Championship. That was my best idea yet, I gotta say. Just giving an intimidating looking guy a championship that's a bunny looking like really nice, giving the colon 3. I'm a pro. The belt, of course, being a gift from the cosmic bunnies themselves. Some call it a curse, but, you know, they gave it to us, so it's a gift. Also, it's cute, so it can't be a curse. I just love that in this version of the game, it's just the name of the champion on the belt. So we have a bunny championship belt with, like, the words Goatman underneath. Here we go. This is where the twerking usually happens. But hey, Goatman's a heel. He's not gonna twerk. Because he hates us. He doesn't want us to have fun. More specifically, he wants you to root against him. That's part of his job. But that's breaking kayfabe. He's a horrible person, and he didn't twerk. That belt. It's almost as cute as my avatar. Let's go. Masked Man so far has lost all of his matches, which is why he's booked for this match, clearly. Well, that's unfair to say. He only lost once, and he won against Dr. Ham, who's proven to be pretty strong. And actually has a title match later up for the LP Superstar Championship belt. And as it looks now, the Masked Man is actually doing quite some damage. Starting out strong. With some moves of a variety, like a punch to the face. Holy crap, that's just pushing the envelope right there. And wow, that's actually, wow. That's a... like, yeah, a power bomb thing, yeah. I kind of caught me off guard, I didn't know what was going to happen. They didn't clear that with me. No, a frog splash springboard. And this match is promising right from the start already. Some high impact moves, and now a dropkick into nothingness. And that's where Goatman is making his comeback. Hit one move as opposed to Masked Man's like 10 and immediately does a taunt. Very classy. I like that guy's style. And his horns. And out the ring again. If this ends in count out, I swear. I swear I'm... I'm gonna cry a little. We're at 5 now, from the looks of it. I'm a bit sad that, like, it doesn't display the count on screen anymore, even though I turned it on. But the reason it doesn't do it for some reason is that during AI matches, it disables any and all of the HUDs, so that's not there. Makes it a bit hard to gauge sometimes how far I count as progress when people, like me, I'm a moron, talk over it. And people sure like this kind of, like, needling DDT this time around. I just need to let you know that I know the names of some moves. That's my gimmick. And that had no sound whatsoever. Standing shooting star press! First moonsaults, now shooting star presses. I didn't know I gave people these moves. But apparently I did. They're good moves though, I'm not gonna complain about that. Oh yeah. High risk. Dropkick straight to the face. And the gold man trying to get his momentum back with some weird-ass reversal move. And oh god, the battering ram headbutt. And now, oh my god, he's going for the MTM out of nowhere, there it is. Goes for the pin, 1, 2! And hey, of course it's a kick out. Just one finisher after all. It takes at least like 3 or 4 these days. So basically, finishers are meaningless. But we all knew that already. Not surprising anyone here. Ooh. Super kick. Man, the super kick kind of... It used to be a Shawn Michaels finisher, and it still would be if he still wrestled, but it's basically become kind of a transitional move at this point. Like, the Young Bucks do it constantly. They just super kick everybody. Like, their gimmick is that they put on a super kick party. It's a nice move, though. And they still buy it as a finisher. And oh, but here, actually, comes a Masked Man's finisher. Oh, yes. The kind of backstabber suplex type move. Another near fall. It's a really good match, I gotta say, though. Back and forth, and they're both, like, you know, doing good. Oh, he's going for something. Whoa! Whoa! Crowd chance, this is awesome. Like, that was a super kick, like, in midair. That's a catch finisher, like it actually is a finisher for him. So it's kind of a miracle it didn't put him down. That was a move, that sure was a move, I gotta say. Oh, now he's going for a move. I'm a bit disappointed whenever people only go to the second rope, but in this game it's kind of weird because not everybody has top rope moves. Some only go to the middle rope, but that's fine, you know. Yeah, stare that back. Nice. He put him down, sitting to the ground, just so he could hit his head. Oh, another battering ram. Apparently he thinks that's enough. But you know, the battering ram is his signature, so now he has a finisher. And there he goes. MGM out of nowhere. Masked Man's bleeding, but rope break. That could have been it. Because, you know, now he's bleeding. We can't tell, of course, because he's wearing a mask, but there was a red flash that means blood. Though it's kind of weird that they even allow blood, because technically speaking, WWE does not officially allow blood. It just sometimes happens. But there's no, like, intentional blood anymore. Except, maybe sometimes, who knows. Apparently there's blood capsules taken and stuff like that. But hey. What am I gonna prove? Wait, was it another headbutt? I just glanced at chat and somehow missed it. Ah well, can't have been that important. Well, of course this match never ends. It's a title match after all. It's gonna be long. Oh, and here we go though. Another MGM out of nowhere. Three! Goatman retains. I think this is the first time the Bunny Championship belt has been successfully defended. That was one hell of a match though. Like, look at this damn highlight. It's just a super kick. It's just super kick masking out of midair. That was nice. I can't say that, that Masked Man didn't fight well, considering the abuse he took. Now, up next, we should have our women's tag match. It's gonna be really embarrassing when it turns out I'm wrong with this other match first, though. Thankfully, I was right, because it would have been embarrassing. Yep, here we go. For some reason, DCB versus Rara, even though they're like loser buddies. But that means one of them will get a win under their belt. But DCB is pretty much always the crowd favorite due to never having won a match before in singles competition. This in singles competition, though. But hey, win's a win if she wins. And a loss, of course, is another loss. But that much is obvious. And here comes a Valerie Easton. I mean, she seems trustworthy. Like, it's not like she's trying to run a coven of witches or something. And, DZB certainly seems like she's a witch, I guess. She, yeah. She seems like a Starbucks employee to me, and nothing screams witch more than Starbucks employee, clearly. Yeah, DCB always had the Ultimate Warrior entrance. Back when I decided on first, I just wanted to pick the most high energy and fastest entrance possible for her, because she's like constantly on caffeine and it's great. And lights out. She's summoning an eclipse, because that's what witches do, did you know? And oh yeah, to some Kirby music, here comes Terrara Fluffy Bottom. Though if the game's nameplate showed up, it would display as Terrara Fluffy Bottom, because there's just so many letters in the name. I don't know. Doesn't allow any more than that. Just need one more drink. I swear, if I'm drunk after this, it's your fault. Well, if she had a bunny tail, it would get squished under her top. I tried to give her a bunny tail. I tried. That game wouldn't let me. And you played your Lancet. Very threatening command and conquer music right there. I'm already scared of this normal looking person. Just look at her, like, an imposing look. She's gonna kick everybody's asses. Right out of the gate, a classic rematch, Rara vs. DZB. Last time this happened, Rara got punched forever. The game broke and there was eternal bunny punches. That was great. DZB has a fun moveset though. That much was shown in her match against Asuka. Lot of flippy stuff. Acrobatic stuff, really nice, fun to look at. Plus, killing the business, which is always good, and hey, that was interesting. But of course I have to root for my girl Rara. Even though DCB, you know DCB just... Wow, that was a... That was a weird powerbomb. Oh well. But yeah, rooting for my girl Rara. She's not here, unfortunately, but hey. She's just gonna do stuff and win. I believe in her. On the other hand, they also see DCB hurt. She didn't do anything to anybody. Except she just ran a Lady of Lancet here, which I guess counts as doing something to someone, but she didn't, like, actually defeat anyone yet. Which is more heartbreaking than anything, because she, you know, obviously deserves it. But eventually, one day, I believe that she will get a singles win. Probably against someone really strong like Helena or, I don't know. Not Asuka. She already lost to Asuka. But if she beats Helena, it'll mean she also beat Asuka, because Helena beat Asuka. This is how it works, right? Oh... This is the Melter Driver! This is the Melter Driver. It's sometimes called the Indie Taker. It's a tombstone pile driver with some weird, like, springboard thing. Like, it doesn't do anything to heighten the impact of the move, it just looks cool. Oh yeah, Rara, kick some ass! Never mind, you're dead, shit. Well, goodness. I think Lady Lance is the tallest currently in the match. She looks like much taller than everybody else. From this angle, anyway. I don't know why, but for some reason the crowd boos every time Rara doesn't move, even though she's a face and Valerie is a heel, and that means that they should cheer. I think the crowd is blocked, clearly. And hey, I didn't give her that move, but she has it. It's kind of disturbing how much I am surprised at the moves that people have, despite designing their movesets. I mean, that might make sense, that the crowd's all for DCB, but DCB wasn't even involved in that sequence, so that doesn't make any sense. Now she's there, though. Oh, wow. That was a move. I like tag moves sometimes. They're sometimes really just crazy and stupid and great. Springboard moves are so much fun. I told you that DCB has a really fun moveset. That looked like she hurt both people equally, but you know. I mean, I think DCB is going for the highlight reel this time around. I'm sure that was supposed to happen that way. Well, Hellmaker, I'm gonna let you in on a secret. DCP has mostly the Young Bucks moveset, which is why she has the Meltzer driver. And the Young Bucks, of course, are very fun to watch tag team. They really boo every time DCB gets hit. No, Hellmaker, Ultimate Warrior wouldn't do flippy shit. He's like really old school, and his main gimmick is that he no-sold everything. Oh yeah, I just really like these moves. Like, pretty much every move DCB has is fun to watch. And yes, her moveset is of course owed to the high caffeine levels. I think at this point she doesn't actually have blood anymore, she just runs on caffeine. Which is why she passed out last season when Dash Rendar stole the coffee. And holy shit, Dash Rendar really is kinda evil! Like, not only did he steal all the food, but also the coffee, and knocked out DCB that way, and then he drank my entire stash. Yeah. Dash is evil. That was a fascinating lag drop. And are we gonna see her finish or whatever this, the bunny beatdown? Oh yeah, that's the bunny beatdown, I think. Maybe. Well, that could have been it, but it wasn't dropped, of course, by Valerie. Now they're just talking to each other, I don't know. Wow! Did you see that? Val just kinda flew away after that punch. And it wasn't necessary anyway, just for good measure. I think Rara snapped. She's normally like not like that. She doesn't do stuff like just punch people for fun. Well, Lancet can't corrupt Rara. It's impossible. I hope. Like, I can't possibly ever turn Rara heel. I can't imagine her as one. It's just impossible. Oh, she's going for the big move now. And of course she misses. Well, it's not like Shane McMahon, who misses every shooting star press he ever does. Another weird kind of backflip neckbreaker move, I guess. I really want to see another Meltzer driver here. Shane is good, Hellmaker, shut up. I mean, he's also bad, but he's also good. He knows how the helicopter crash, so there's that. And a one, and a two, and a kick out. Yeah, come on, Rara, show her, you can do it, I believe in you. Is that a chokeslam? No, it's not a chokeslam. That would have screwed me up. Rara wouldn't do such a vicious move. But that leg drop, that's cool. Stylish and flashy. The standard corner reversal. I think everybody asked that. Every single buddy. Oh. Why are they booing when she hits Val? Val's a heel. Val's a heel. And the face is attacking the heel. That should be a cheer. Come on, game. What are you doing? Now that Lancet whiffs a move, they cheer. Come on, I'm really confused right now. Discus elbow. So much booing. I'm kind of like upset about this. They should cheer her. Cheer her. She's good. She's nice. And she makes cupcakes for everybody for free. In case you were wondering what she did on the top rope there, that was just the bunny perch. It's her signature move. Ouch. Oh, that was a bunny beatdown. It looks like a move that should hurt Rara more than her opponent, but hey, you know. And hey, a discus elbow from DCB this time. They're both competitors out cold for the time being. That's fun. Normally the ref would start a count now. Up to 10, so both have a chance to get up. Why are you going for DZB, Rara? Come on, that's not like you. What's wrong? Something happened? Oh, that's the kiss of death. Her finisher. And one, two, and there we go. Valerie East, because that's just how names are cut off. And DZB won. DCB won. It was a tag team victory, but it's still a victory nonetheless, so good on her. Good on her. Can't wait for her inevitable and eventual singles victory, though. That was a weird match, though. Like, it was a team of face and heel versus a team of face and heel. Next up, we have, the Superstar title match. Oh, but it looks like Konami Koda is on her way to the ring. Maybe there's something with Black's title. Which she promised last week she would destroy because it's evil. And yep, there we go. This is Black's title. A demonic artifact. Part of the blood and suffering of innumerable victims, of course. This hasn't come up any time before this, but now the belt is clearly evil. And I have no idea what be locked inside of it anyway. Because Black, the person that the title is named after, did not like go into the title. Instead, he got consumed by Fiat, which is a fate worse than... Oh man, what's this? Oh man, it's a Gendo pose on the Titantron. It's a bit offending that Konami doesn't know who that is, clearly. Chumpy Chan, and of course, in the background, her best friend, John Cena. Wearing a very stylish Fist of the North Star t-shirt. Chumpy Chan didn't, like, just hold the Kawaii title, she actually invented it back when I was making LPFWA. I was looking for a name for the title. I was trying to call it the Women's Championship, and she just said, "Nah, it's gonna be the Kawaii title," and that's how that got named. And if you are going, what the hell now? That only means that you're probably at least somewhat sane. And she always called Black's title Pokemon's title because. That, what she says here. Perfect sense. Next week at Anime Showdown, our first pay-per-view. Which, I don't know, it's called pay-per-view, but you don't actually have to pay anything for it. And she has the ultimate Goku Way title, whatever that is. She has it, though. Amazing stuff. That just happened, yeah. It happened. But now, there's the LP Superstar Championship match that I promised you. Coming right up. It's of course Dr. Ham, who's had some wins under his belt, and Thundercat Crhis Pine. And they just love Dr. Ham's entrance. Coming out of Goldberg's locker room, number 12 this time. I mean, I'm sure Dr. Ham can handle a guy pretending to be a cat. He's a pretty good record so far. He was originally supposed to have an appointment with Fruit Sniffer, I think, but instead he got this title shot. I mean appointment, special appointment. With some extra perks, that's what I mean, yeah. And here we go, the LP Superstar Bell looks really nice this time around. Unfortunately, that tail he's having right now will disappear in the match, because yes, this game won't allow for tails during matches. Apparently, they're an unfair advantage. After all, you could, like, whip someone with it. Like, Bianca Belair from NXT and the Mae Young Classic actually has, like, really long hair, and she used it as a whip. It's legal. It's part of our body. Hair pulling, on the other hand, is illegal. How much did I drink yet? Come on, I need to check. Oh man, that bottle is half empty. The title's pretty though. Hair as a whip is a good idea. A very good idea. And yes, I will drink more. Give me some time though, I just gotta space it out a little bit. To not overdo it. I mean, I could take like a sip for every suplex, but these aren't really suplex heavy wrestlers. And no twerking again, of course, why not? Fucking hell, I'm right now disappointed in myself for not thinking about that to give people like the twerk. It's not a twerk, it's supposed to be like, I don't know what it's supposed to be, but it's something that's supposed to happen, and it's happening. Except this time. Well, let's see if Dr. Ham can help that cat with her back pains, or whatever it is, I don't know. Well, the cat is showing immediately, though, why he's champion. Never mind, Ham shows why he has a title shot now. Well, Ham, the twerk is universal. It can happen anytime. During title matches, anyway. Like, I know it depends on the animation that I set for people to have before a title match, but I didn't know they would actually twerk, because the animation is supposed to be like fluent. They just do like a roll on the ground, then they jump up, hold the title up, but hey, apparently they poise ready for the pose during their introduction, which never happens because they have commentary turned off. But you know, I'll take the twerking any day. It's good. Very good. The best part though was when it first happened, and Lotus immediately afterwards also did a dab. That killed me. It killed Rara more though. Like, she was very consumed by her fit of laughter. And hey, that's a move! Straight to the mat. Nice, nice job. Can't always land on their feet. Exactly, that. Already going for the pin? Seriously? I mean, a one count is a one count. It's better than people just kicking out immediately. Yeah, next time Ham has to bring like sedatives to actually be prepared for this match. Then again, it might be considered cheating. And Ham hasn't been a heel yet. Like he has like all these profession type gimmicks, but doesn't mean he's evil. Just means that he's like dedicated to performing his job well. Yeah. How would you miss that twice? Come on, dude. Well, at least that hit. That would have been embarrassing. Like, one time the cat actually tried to, like, yeah, do stuff. Just went flat on his belly. He sure loves to go for the pinfalls, even though he didn't really do anything high impact. Well, that just means he has a higher chance of pinning people early, I guess. Sometimes that happens. And we go outside yet another time. Wait, is this gonna be a dive? It's gonna be a dive, isn't it? It's gonna be a dive. A dive? Is it? What are you doing? He was poising for a dive, but somehow didn't go through with the animation. So Ham had time to just get up and walk away from it. I have no idea. Usually it's a canned animation, it's not supposed to happen, but it happened. I'm fine with it. Oh, and here we go. This is the scratching post. Some of you might know better as the Styles Clash. And of course, Ham kicks out of a frickin' Styles Clash. I mean, scratching post. Yeah, Ham sure likes to bleed. That's true. He bled last time. When he was against, I think, Toad? It was Toad, right? I should know this. I don't. One, two, and of course kick out. Well, I can check what match it was. Just easy. I'm not gonna look at the match now. Actually, I'm gonna. But you know, I can check the match card for last week and not seem like a total fool. Even though I clearly am a total fool. Don't tell anybody though. They're not gonna believe you because they think I'm very smart. Everybody does. It was Fruity Toad and Dr. Ham in a triple threat last week. And now I'm back to the match. Oh hey, that's interesting. That's exactly what I expected to see when I came back. I mean, the carry system clearly doesn't work that well with the AI. But how well? Oh, are we gonna see something? Something from the top rope? Exciting. Just a middle rope superplex, but it's fine. It's still high impact. I still like it. Could have been like much more like hard hitting from the top rope, brutal and everything. Maybe with a couple flips. Maybe a Canadian destroyer from the top rope. That would be sweet. Seriously, if there's a Canadian destroyer from the top rope, I'm gonna give it to myself as a finisher. And I'll book myself every show just so I can see it. Cause I'm that kind of guy. Yes, Sam, just stand there. The AI is seriously great about how he's going for the spinal cracker now. Come on, do it, buddy. That it is, yeah. First the back, then the neck. And the third near fall. Maybe I should try to yell the move names in a really high pitch like Joey Styles did, the only other person who ever did solo commentary on wrestling. Then again, maybe that might be a bad idea, because my high-pitched voice is not very... How do I put it, easy on the ears? So I'm not gonna do it. Maybe I will, I need a couple more, sips for that. Who knows, the show still lasts for a bit. Might happen. And ooh, here we go again with the scratch and post. Like, in wrestling is actually one of the most devastating moves, because, well, for most moves to take it safely, you need to tuck your chin. For the Styles Clash, aka scratching post, you need to, like, tilt your head back, because otherwise your neck might break. That's happened before. Someone's neck broke due to that move. But oh well, you know. Still, Ham kicked out of it twice so far. Maybe that's not blood. Maybe that's like... I know, oh, pin. Never mind. Maybe that's, like, ketchup? I know. This is PG after all, we don't have blood. Just, wholesome things everywhere in this show about people hitting each other, like, all the time, and doing, like, stuff to each other that you shouldn't do to anybody ever in real life. Like a dropkick to the back. Fucked up. Well, this is a hard-fought match, though. There's some decent back and forth here, even though, like, there was, like, kicking out of a frickin' Styles Clash. I mean, scratching post. That's what it's called. I think here we go again. Is this gonna be it? I like that he just voluntarily puts his, like, arms around his legs. And a one, and a two, and a kick out. That's kind of a holy shit moment, to be honest. Three finishers, and he still kicks out. I wonder how this land. Ham certainly doesn't lose easy. If anything, all this proves that he deserved this title shot. And a one and a two. Like, any pinfall attempt at this point could probably finish the match. It's been going for a while, and there's been finishes exchanged, and it's kind of nuts that nobody is legitimately dead by this point. Oh, are we gonna see another Nah, I was hoping for like another top rope move, but oh, what? Okay, okay, Bulldog. It's okay. I will accept that as a move that happened. Oh, we're going to the outside again. To the ramp again. If this is gonna be a double count out, like, well, I don't know. Just, I don't know. Maybe you should make it a rule that the title changes hands, even if it's like a count out victory, but in case of double count out, that doesn't matter, I suppose. Is this 7? 9, oh man. Of course. And the game won't give us a victory animation for some reason, so this is what we get. This is the perfect picture to end this match. It's perfect. I'm not gonna complain about that one, like... Now let's move on to our next match, the number one contenders match for the LPFWA Championship. It will be Toad, who is undefeated and has a, had very impressive matches against Emperor Palpatine, who didn't earn shit. On screen, at least, but we're gonna pretend that he did off screen before this season started. Somehow had matches and won a couple times, maybe? We're gonna pretend that happened, okay? Anyway, Toad is both the best and American made. Like Hulk Hogan, who is very American? This is WCW entrance theme. I'm not sure which one's more American, his like WWF theme called Real American. Or is it called Real American? I'm not sure. What's this one called? I don't even know. Also something American. Anyway, USA, USA. This is a mushroom representing the United States of America. I wonder what that says about the USA. I don't know. I'm not gonna pretend to know. I'm not gonna pretend why a mushroom is representing the USA. I just need another swig. There we go. That hits the spot. By the end of this, I might be dead. And here we go, it's Emperor Palpatine coming out with the classic Imperial March rap mashup. It's really great. And for since my Gear Crow is the person who submitted Palpatine, there's the SLW logo, and you know, if you know SLW, or rather, Crow's TEW13 LP, which sadly got abandoned, the current incarnation that is. And the last one too, I think. Well, you'll know what SLW is. He's desperately trying to make it a thing. Yeah, Puppy's great, isn't he? I mean, he's shit, he's very bad. He's... Let's just tell you what he did last season to Iggy Ixon. He chokeslammed him through the ring to set him on fire, and then Iggy went on vacation. And Palpy took over LPFWA and turned it into SLW. And eventually there was the SLW Revival pay-per-view. And then Iggy came back from vacation and ended it, because that's what happened. Also, Palpy got dunked on hard, because, you know, it's gonna happen. But hey, now he has a chance to become the number one contender. He actually got fired at the end of episode 3. Season 2! Damn it. What's wrong with me? I think I talked to this bottle too much. And by talked, I mean I drank from it too much. But anyway, Palpy got fired after the end of last season. But he somehow has a job back now, so let me explain real quick how that happened. Well, okay, let me first give you a kind of paraphrased excerpt from an interview with the Pro Wrestling Observer. With Palpy. Dave Meltzer had that interview with Emperor Palpatine. And what Palpy said was basically that he was on his way back to Earth, on his escape pod from the moon. But then decided, out of the good of his heart, to come back to good old Iggy Ixon. To, you know, join LPFWA again, because he's such a good guy, even though he got fired for the preposterous idea of suggesting that maybe the moon is actually a space station, and that they could prevent the moon from going into the sun by just turning on the engines. But that's laughable, come on! This is the moon! Like, THE moon! Not the fucking Death Star. It's the moon. He came back and just said, yeah, okay, I'm gonna work for you again because you're a good guy. I'm Emperor Palpatine. And then he also said suck it and did like the DX crotch chops. But hey, that's Palpatine. But what really happened is that he came crawling back. And I decided to give him like a job again. But he has to start from the bottom. To which he responded, hell yeah! That means I get a promotion, because previously he was forced to do interviews only after doing the whole SLW revival thing. And that's Palpy's story, that's how I got back into LPFWA. I'm such a good person. I realize that he also claims he's back because he's such a good person, but I'm the good person here, okay? I'm the good person. Not somebody else. It's me, Iggy, the good guy. In any case, here's a match happening. Toad's doing stuff to Palpy. I'm sure Palpy loves it. And that's his signature already, the leg drop. Straight to the throat. He could do the FU2 at any moment now. And Palpy, of course, could do either the Imperial Powerbomb or the Galactic Elbow. Both of which are reasonably flashy moves, certainly flashier than Toad just standing there looking at Palpy on the ground. Oh, this is the FU2. Is it gonna happen? It is gonna happen. And it's a 1, it's a 2, it's... actually, at 2.9, this early in the match. But obviously, it would be very disappointing if it ended this early, so Palpy's gonna do stuff, like this weird, leg stretch thing. I'm not gonna pretend to know what it's called. That's what it's called now. Ah yes, the dreaded, touching the head and doing a motion move. Yeah. That's what we're looking for at this point in time. Is it a cross face camel clutch? That's probably a better name for this. But you know, my gimmick is knowing some move names, not all of them. I can make up the rest. I thought he was gonna go for the desperate pin attempt, but hey, Toad gets up too quick. Cause you know, Toad is kind of a monster. Well, that certainly was a thing. I I just love Palpy's shitty bathrobe. Like, he has a shittier and shittier attire with every incarnation. Previously had like a bathrobe that at least went down to his ankles. Now it only really goes down to like his knees basically, and well. Oh man, Strange Forest, I am glad that you didn't really miss your guy's match yet. I say guys, but it's actually a tree. It's next. Whoa. I just shut up just to hear the "this is awesome" chants from the crowd, because that was a thing. Yeah, maybe Toad vs. Goat is gonna happen eventually. Next week, after all, is the big pay-per-view, which might have some more high-stakes matches. Like a double title match for Bunny's championship, as well as the... Well, he doesn't have... Actually, no, he can't have the match next time, unless he loses. Well, we'll see how that ends. It depends on the outcome of this match. Yeah, that move Poppy did that I was so wowed by is actually an OMG moment. It counts as a finisher and thus more damage than the finisher. The only problem is it's outside of the ring, so you can't follow up with a pin, and it doesn't really have that like bonus to the pin. Anyway, it was a fun move, and the crowd chanted "this is awesome" once more, so I'm already into it. Oh, is that the... could it be? It's the Imperial Powerbomb! That's one of his finishers. The other won't be the Galactic Elbow, which obviously is the true finisher. But yeah, I'd be hyped for Toad vs. Goat, man. We might see it eventually. I mean, we most certainly will, to be honest, because eventually the two will meet if they both do well. But again, this is some real good match so far. You can't really say that any of the two are doing poorly. They just do stuff. Hell, we had an OMG moment already. And those are always fun when they happen. Oh man, it's another FU too. And a one, and a two, and that's it. Toad actually gets a shot at the LPFWA Championship next week against the current LPFWA champion, Nuffkins, the human. Not a dinosaur, a human. I mean, even if there were a dinosaur, he doesn't look like a dinosaur, but let's just pretend that at one point there was some pretense that he's a dinosaur. He's a dinosaur though, right? He is. In the USSA. Why am I singing? How did that fall so far? I shouldn't sing. Singing is one of the deadly sins of LP. Then again, this isn't an LP, this is a wrestling show. And no one's playing a game anyway. Well, there we go. That song, by the way, was co-written and I think also sung by Terry Funk. No, not Terry Funk. Who was it? It wasn't Terry Funk. It was, I forget the name. Man, I'm blanking out on that. I'm sure someone here knows who I mean. And here comes the LPFWA champion to face his challenger for next week. And he's gonna do it his way. Yes. Not sure if I'm hyped about this match yet, but I suppose I am. Nuffkins used to come in Hulk Hogan's attire and later Stone Cold Steve Austin's attire, and probably a couple of popular wrestler attires in between. But today, he's just coming in as Nuffkins. Or a young lion, because in New Japan Pro Wrestling, young lions have like a black speedos, black knee pads, black elbow pads, and that's it. That's all they get. And ooh, the classic champ versus challenger face-off with a title between the two. It's exciting, isn't it? I'm sure you're now very hyped for the next match. Well, the next match, I mean like the one that happens next week, where Toad challenges Nuffkins. Of course, he's healing it up though. Oh yes. Nuffkins wants to earn his clothes now. I mean, let's be real here. This vest is merch. It's sold as merch. He bought one already. He could just wear it. He could just wear it. But I gotta give credit to Nuffkins. He wants to earn it somehow. So let's see what attire Nuffkins ends up with. But to actually earn an attire, he needs to, well, win. He needs to win. That's something that needs to happen. And here's the next match. It's a tree versus the big dog, Roman Reigns. If you somehow don't know who Roman Reigns is, it's the guy WWE is currently grooming as John Cena's successor as the top babyface of the company, but they're kind of failing because the crowd sees straight through it and just boos Roman Reigns. Roman Reigns is by no means bad, is the thing. He's actually kind of good, but the crowd still doesn't like him, and to be even more honest, his character is kind of bland. He's good in the ring, he's fun to watch, but he's bland. That's the problem. Anyway, here's a tree versus Roman Reigns. Here's a tree versus Roman Reigns. I never thought I'd say that, but it's gonna happen. Yeah, well, Roman's promos were bad. They got better. They're still not really great, but they're better than they used to be. He's improving. So maybe one day he will actually be able to cut a decent promo. But yeah, I think Roman gets kind of an unfair rap. Then again, being groomed as John Cena's successor is kind of like a tough burden to bear. He is, I think, better kept as a member of the Shield, which had a reunion recently, so the Shield is back and Roman Reigns is part of the Shield. And the fun bit is, Roman as a member of the Shield actually gets cheered. Funny how that works, huh? Funny how that works. What I love though, and I mentioned this in the Discord when I was recording the match, the crowd boos Reigns, even in this game, even though at this point I would say WWE would say, nah, you haven't cheered. Because what they used to do is that they would like just pipe in cheers when Roman came in for like recorded pay-per-views. Not for live performances, obviously, but for like recorded pay-per-views, Rome would get like some canned cheers just so he could... they could pretend that he was like beloved by the fans. And the thing with Roman is too that they were teasing a heel turn for a long time. At one point he was legitimately trying to kill Braun Strowman, but for some reason Roman is still a face. Not a heel. He tried to kill a guy, but he's a face. He had Braun Strowman in the back of an ambulance and backed it up into a production truck. And he's a face. He's one of the good guys. He's a good guy, yeah. Frankly, I think that Roman would be better put as either a heel or a member of the Shield, of course, which he is right now, so that's good on them. Hell make a good point there regarding Cena and The Rock. Of course, no one really hates The Rock as a thing. People hate Cena, though, but with Cena, I have to say, it's kind of really unfair because he started off as a heel, then became a face, and now people want him to be a heel again, even though his heel run, while fun, wasn't all, like, it wasn't much better than his face run, it's a thing. And people tend to forget that he ever was a heel, even though he was. In any case, here's Dog Song in the background, because Roman Reigns is the big dog, and this is his yard now. My favorite Roman Reigns moment is when he, like, the Raw after he beat The Undertaker at WrestleMania and kind of retired him. He came to the ring at Raw after WrestleMania, just soaked in all of the boost that he got for a moment, smiled a little bit, smirked a little bit, and then just said, "This is my yard now." And I thought for sure that was going to be a heel turn for him, but it wasn't. I'm really confused about Roman Reigns, I'm going to be honest here. He's not bad by any means, I have to say that, but still. He's the big dog now, and this is his yard. Well, John Cena kind of did that already with Roman Reigns. I think it was supposed to be a passing the torch moment, but it fell really flat. Then again, it was kind of a feel-good moment, because after John Cena lost, before he left the ring, he got thank you Cena chants, which is a bit heartwarming, because normally there's like, even though they're kind of more endearing than anything, let's go Cena, Cena sucks chance. And I'm pretty sure at this point in time, the people who do the chance, the sucks and let's go chance are the same people. Because I would do the same, I just chant both. Because I like John Cena. John Cena is a good wrestler and he didn't get an unfair push. He's actually that good. It's just that it took a while for people to warm up to him again after he got like this really, really, like, intense push. Hey, at least Roman gets put a rope against his throat. He gets thropped on it, and at this point, I'm actually feeling the alcohol that I drank, so yeah. For this final match, I am going to be aware that I'm kind of shit-faced. And later on down this night, I'm gonna actually watch NXT TakeOver, which is gonna happen, how late is it? 1.5 hours from now. But see, the thing is, Hellmaker, like, Hogan actively tried to be like, perceived as really strong, and he refused to lose. But Cena didn't really, like, feel that way to me, even though he won a lot for a long time. I think he's actually a legitimately good guy, because let's just take his, like, Make-A-Wish record. I think at this point he has, like, 400 Make-A-Wish wish fulfillments? Maybe I'm exaggerating here, I don't even know, and it's a 1 and a 2. And, well, whatever. Anyway, like, John Cena, like, had so many Make-A-Wish wishes come through. I can't really view him as, like, a bad person or anything, or undeserving of his status. as the top guy. And now it seems like he's going for like a movie career like The Rock did. Which I hope he's successful in, because again, John Cena is actually good. I was one of the first guys who hated John Cena back when he still had his original heel run in like 2006-ish. Which is right around when I just kind of started hating wrestling. And eventually I came back, but still. I hated John Cena a long time because I didn't like his original run. Which was the run that other people actually liked, and now I like his face run? I don't know. Like his basically perpetual face run. Yep, that's true. Hogan also kind of is a... well... a bit of a prick. Like... when it became clear that he is kind of offensively racist. Like, even though he was kind of a mediocre performer at best, and tried to kind of like make himself look strong above all else, even though he grew older and older, and his job at his age would be to put over the newer talent, he refused to do so. Oh yeah, John Cena's rap CD, that's where his theme song comes from. Both of his theme songs, actually, and they're not even that bad as a thing. He's kind of decent at rapping. And the near fall again. The tree's doing stuff. The tree's not like dying or anything. Fun fact: Roman Reigns is the highest rated wrestler in WWE 2K18. He has a rating of 95, and this tree here only has 87. Oh man, I didn't know about that farting background, but hey, I'm gonna buy it. It makes sense. I wouldn't put it beyond John Cena to be a bit immature, especially in his old days when he had this basic thugonomics gimmick, which in retrospect I think was actually really fun. I didn't like it back then, when I like actually watched the shows at the time, but now I think it's kind of a fun gimmick. It's ridiculous, and he was actually kind of decent at his dumb rapping and rhyming gimmick that I kind of like it now. And one, two, of course, it's not even a close one. Because when a dog pisses against the tree, what happens if the tree pisses back? Yes, just stand there. Look at Roman Reigns. In case you didn't notice, all of these songs I am playing in the background are somewhat dog themed. There was dog song, there was the Silent Hill Dog ending theme, and now there's the theme of the Great Grey Wolf Sif from Dark Souls. So there's that. Because Roman Reigns is the big dog, and this is his yard now. By the way, this is taking place at the WrestleMania 33 arena, which was the event where Roman Reigns defeated The Undertaker. And, well, it wasn't explicitly stated that he ended his career, but The Undertaker has, by all accounts, pretty much retired at this point. Which at one point is sad, but on the other hand, he's had his run. It's better for him to end it now than to just go on until he breaks down completely. He's had one of the most prestigious careers in the business ever, according to some of the best gimmicks ever, and there was the Superman punch just now, which is his signature, I believe. It should be. Just for good measure, let's just take another swig. I really shouldn't, but I am. I'm immune to hangovers anyway, so I can drink whatever I want. It's all good now. This match actually going on for quite a while already. Oh, the ref's checking on the tree! He took quite a bit of damage. But actually, the tree should probably be, like, finished by now. But he's not, he's persevering, because he is, after all, a tree. Like, an actual tree. I think. He looks humanoid. Honestly, I don't even know what he is anymore. But he certainly exists. I just hope that the fucking tree never becomes the LPFWA champion, so I don't have to say, yeah, our champ was a tree once. Like, just a tree. Yeah, go Roman, just kill him. Go for it. With that elbow drop and whatever you're gonna do. Oh yeah, it's a spear. The Roman spear. He reversed it, what a dick. I don't know what happened, but I'm now rooting for Roman. And now we have Blade Wolf's theme from Metal Gear Rising Revengeance. Another theme befitting of the big dog. Okay, Ham, this isn't even that funny, but it made me laugh really hard. You might be right that headbutting a tree isn't very smart, but that tree sold it, so it's either a very strong headbutt or a very weak tree. Ooh, Roman Reigns is bleeding now. You know, it'd be funny if the tree bled too. Trees don't bleed. What's this? It looked like he was going for the razor's edge, but then he just straight up put him in the powerbomb position and whatever. Wait, oh shit, you're right, the tree's bleeding and someone missed that. Probably during one of my rants about, like, John Cena actually being good, or Roman Reigns not being that bad. I can't believe we have a tree bleeding live on stream. This is the PG era. Holy shit, another spear. Holy crap. That should be it. Because the spear is actually his finisher, and no, it's not it. It's not it. It's not it. It might be sap, you're right, it might be sap. But I'm not sure at this point. I'm not sure. I'm actually kind of confused right now. A little bit. Not a lot, but a little bit. Yes, Roman, stare at that tree. Oh yeah, let's do it. Oh no, punch for the gut, holy shit, no. Roman, please don't lose to that tree. Or do, it's fine if you lose to a tree, it's fine, okay? You lost to other people too after. Oh, wow, that's his finisher! The tree falling! While no one is watching or listening. Can you hear it? It's in your fall, though. In case you care, I am drinking cinnamon shots straight out the bottle because I'm horrible. And they think I took a couple too many. Hey, look at this. The tree's doing stuff to Roman Reigns. Like a chop, I think it was a throat chop. I can't be sure ever. Like, the chops have different names, but they technically look the same. Maybe it was a brain chop. I don't even know. I like that the tree is just standing there a lot of the time. Almost like he's an actual tree. But then again, he does sell Roman's punches. It seems right now that... Oh, it's not a finisher. It's the tree falling while no one's watching. Can you hear it? It's a one, it's a two, and... Three? Tree? One, two, tree? I can't believe a fucking tree beat Roman Reigns at WrestleMania! Holy shit. Holy shit. The tree beat Roman Reigns at WrestleMania, sponsored by Snickers. Sponsored by fucking Snickers. I'm dying inside right now. I'm dead inside. I'm done with this. Thankfully, this is over now. Because that would have killed me if it happened earlier in the night, but... To be frank, I knew who was gonna win. I just didn't know how or how long it would take. It's weird. It's weird. Anyway, people. Thank you all for watching. I love you all intensely. I'm not drunk at all. I'm not whispering right now. I'm actually yelling. Please. Please love me. Please. I love you too. I'm not drunk. I'm sober. Anyway, it's over now. So, thanks y'all for watching and see y'all next time. Have a good night. I'm certainly gonna watch NXT in a couple hours if I'm not passing out till then. But until then, I hope you're fine. I had a good time with the show. Even though it's me on my own and I got very drunk at the end. Goodbye. Mwah. And good night. Bang. That's Kenny Omega's, like, ending promo. Anyway, bye. See ya. Bye.